thanks for coming after lunch. I'm sorry I rushed in late and didn't get a chance to chat with anybody. They kept us over in our session, but it was wonderful. So it's very exciting to be here. And at the lunch, all of the faculty were together, and it's exciting stuff going on at the different CCCU schools around diversity and some real passion and movement. So one of the things, and I don't know why that's glitzing out like that, but one of the things that comes up as we become more diverse as a Christian community is the issue of microaggressions. So microaggressions have kind of burst onto the major media scene. It's a concept that you hear a lot about now. And so I was asked to come and talk a little bit about implicit bias and microaggressions, and you know, what are they and what do we do about them? What do we do with them as we engage in community together? So what I'll start with is kind of introducing you to the concept of implicit bias. How many of you guys have heard the concept implicit bias? Oh, good. Some, but not all. All right, so implicit bias basically refers to the associations that we store in our memory that can influence our behaviors and judgments. So they're like thought bits, okay? They're very basic ideologies that are ideas that we inherited typically from our heritage cultures, our social contexts, that are really automatic thoughts that we have whether or not we're aware that we're having them. They operate automatically, and they operate without substantial cognitive resources being utilized. What that means is we don't have to put a lot of energy into thinking to get those automatic thoughts. They happen without any mental energy being exerted, really. And they often happen so quickly that we may not even be aware that they're happening. Okay. So what I'd like to do is start with a self-observation activity. Okay. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you if you have a pen and paper. I'm going to show you a few minute YouTube clip of a comedian. And while you're watching this clip, I want you just to write down any unfiltered, immediate, automatic thoughts that you have. You're not going to share them with anybody else, so you don't need to filter. This is just completely for you to notice what goes on in your thinking as you're watching this video, okay? Okay, so write down, if you haven't yet, write down any unfiltered, automatic, immediate thoughts that came to your mind as you were watching that, okay? And we'll come back to this idea in a minute. Implicit biases, so they tend to exert influence on how we think, how we behave, and very often it's an undesirable influence on how we think and how we behave. It's not uncommon for us to like self-monitor and catch ourselves thinking thoughts that we wish we wouldn't think, or engaging in behavior based on instinctive, automatic, implicit biases that we wish we wouldn't do. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we inherit those from our cultural socialization process, the cultures in which we were embedded and raised. And part of the social culturalization process is to teach us what we think and believe about our in-groups, our cultural groups, our religious groups, the different cultural groups we belong to. Part of the socialization is, what do we think about ourselves? What do we believe? What do we value? What are our traditions? But part of it is also, what do we think about people who aren't part of this group? What do we think about the people that are our out-groups that maybe we have as alliances with? They're our allies. Or out-groups that we don't have alliances with. Out-groups that are considered enemies or hostile to our in-group. Part of that socialization, where we get those implicit biases, is coming at us as we're maturing as children, and both are internalized, both become automatized and become implicit biases. Part of the challenge of talking about implicit biases is, even though it's an automatic process that occurs as people are raised in their social context, it is very often in our cultures made unconscious through the subtle veil of colorblind orientation. So here in the United States, most of us have been raised with the idea that to be colorblind is to be culturally appropriate, that if I interact with you as a person rather than a person of color or a person of a particular ethnic or cultural group, then we don't have any biases. Okay? And so this idea of we treat people like people in the Christian community, that we're all children of God, we all are image bearers, that philosophy can veil us from knowing and noticing our implicit biases, because it's not talked about, and in fact the opposite is talked about. And then those implicit biases that we don't acknowledge and we don't talk about get reinforced through our social patterns. Okay, they get reinforced in our in-group cohesion. Okay, when I mentioned to my cultural psychology class yesterday that at APU that I was coming to talk at Biola, they gave a verbal response that was not very nice. apparently Biola is APU's outgroup, and when we got here, to be fair, when we got here this morning and we introduced ourselves at registration as being from APU, they're like, oh. So all in good fun, but that's in-group, out-group dynamics, right? And so in-group cohesion can be increased by shared out-group orientation. Okay, so being part of a group, those implicit biases are reinforced in that in-group, out-group relationship. Ethnocentrism is another way that our implicit biases are kept unaware from us. So ethnocentrism refers to the basic fact that when you're being raised in a particular culture, pick any culture, you're raised to value that culture and to see that culture as really a good culture, right? And so if you were raised in, for instance, a Baptist church, and you go to visit a Presbyterian church, you like your Baptist church better, okay? And that leads to ethnocentrism, which is essentially the idea that we tend to judge other cultures by the values, beliefs, behaviors, traditions of our own culture. Okay? Because our culture, if our parents did their job right, we value our cultures, right? We like where we come from. We like who we come from. And so ethnocentrism is that tendency to use our own cultural values to make determinations, judgments about other groups. And so that reinforces implicit biases, because we tend to see the other as not as good as our own in-group. Okay? Social cultural dominance and the cultural hierarchy also reinforces it. So in addition to our in-group, out-group, we're all situated in a bigger society, the United States, where there is a clear cultural, social, racial hierarchy that says this group is more valuable than this group, and that group is more valuable than this group, and kind of ranks, in a sense, cultural groups in the United States by things like race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, etc. And so ability is another one. And so that cultural hierarchy that the American society, regardless of what cultural group within the United States you're from, we all grew up with that same society telling us what is considered more or less valuable in the U.S. Complicating it even further is our social taboo. We have an illusion of being a post-racial society that has created a social taboo. So it looks like almost everybody in the room is probably in college right now. And so you're 18 to 22, 23 years of age. Barack Obama has been the president pretty much for the bulk of your memory, at least your abstract reasoning memory. And so you've probably heard a lot about, now that we have a black president, we're post-racial. There isn't a race problem in America. Everything is good. And so when we talk about, yeah, maybe not, that there's a social taboo against that. We're not supposed to have a problem. And if we don't talk about the problem, then there isn't one. And every time you try to talk about the problem, you're creating the problem. Okay, so the inability to discuss the fact that we all carry implicit biases reinforces them. It keeps them active. It keeps us from doing anything with them. Okay, so So here's the question. If implicit bias are normative, we all have them, and they're automatic, and they're reinforced by all of our context, is there anything that we can do about it? Okay. And really, there's a couple steps. There's lots of we can do about it. The first step is awareness, and the second one is to develop ourselves around that. And I'm sorry about this thing. I don't know what's happening there. There are three kinds of awareness that we can work on in exploring our implicit biases. The first one is epistemic awareness. We have to know that implicit biases exist. Okay? By being here, you now know. We all have implicit biases, we all carry them, we all inherited them, and we own them, we have them. Okay? So that's the first one. So you're already on the way to being able to successfully do something productive with your implicit biases. The second awareness is introspective awareness, and that is developing an awareness of the content of your implicit biases. Okay? So that's why when I showed you the video, I asked you to just write down unfiltered thoughts. Okay? I know we're supposed to filter our thoughts, but write them down unfiltered because you have to become aware of them. Sometimes our thinking process is so quick that we suppress those implicit biases with filters before we acknowledge them. But they still exert an influence over us without us even being aware of it. It still will affect how we interact with people, how we think internally, both about ourselves and diverse others. And so being willing to reflect, open up, pay attention to your own internal automatic processes, be very helpful. The third type of awareness is attribution or observational awareness. And what that means is once you recognize that you have the internal biases and you begin to recognize what those internal biases are, you need to begin to observe how do they affect your behavior? How do they affect what you do? Okay? And that's a hard one. We have a tendency to want to not see ourselves doing things that we wish we wouldn't do. Right? There's very few people, I'm not going to say no one, there are very few people who want to be biased. There's very few people who want to treat people disparagingly or differently based on phenotypic issues. What do you look like? What group do you belong to? So most of us don't want to do that. Okay? So we mostly try to avoid having to notice when we do that. Okay? And so, some of the challenges that we have with doing those awarenesses can be overcome. We have to recognize these two things about ourselves. One is that failure of attention can get in the way. Okay? If we don't self-observe, then we can't be held responsible for what we're not aware of. Right? So it might be easier to not look internally and see what's going on in there. Right? However, as Holroyd said, lacking the motive to reflect on oneself can indicate what one takes to be worthy of moral scrutiny. Basically, if we're not willing to look at it, then we're not seeing it as a moral issue. Okay? How many of you guys were in a presentation either at lunch or this morning that really established the biblical basis of doing the work of diversity, of multiculturalism, that this is important and scripture tells us it's important? Okay, some of you, you guys have heard that somewhere else though? Okay, because this is not part of my presentation to establish that. Take my word for it. It's important. It's all over the Bible. and so this is an important issue. This is about loving one's neighbor. This is about serving each other. This is about being in unity, in a spirit of unity as a community of believers. And so we need to not use failure of attention as an excuse for not doing it. I didn't notice it. I don't see it being an issue. So we have to recognize that that's a tendency for us to do. If we don't see our problems, then we don't have to do anything about them, right? Self-deception is another challenge that can get in the way, and that is when we're motivated to avoid reflection that will confront us with something that we don't like about ourselves. We have a tendency internally to pay attention to thoughts, ideas, our internal processes that reinforce our beliefs about ourselves as being good, Okay? I'm unbiased, I'm a good person, I'm this, I'm that, all the positive attributes that we tend to want to have about ourselves. Self-deception is where we pay attention to things that reinforce that, that say, yep, that's true, see, I am that way, and ignore the things that counter that. Okay? So we wanna be really aware that we have a propensity to self-deception. And so to ask ourselves, when I'm seeing things that reinforce my positive view of myself, am I seeing anything that reinforces those things about myself I'd rather not have be there? Implicit biases are important. Some of you may think, okay, so if this is so automatic, and why are we talking about it? Why should we work on this? Why is it important? Implicit biases are the foundations of how we form our stereotypes, our explicit biases, and our oppressive behavior. Okay. Those come from our implicit biases. So it's real important that we do some self-auditing around implicit biases, because if we don't, we tend to form stereotypes, biases, and engage in oppressive behavior without really thinking it through, without really making that decision before you act on that, before you have your stereotypes and biases and oppressions. Okay, so that's going to lead us to talk about oppression. So where are we at today with oppression? So implicit biases lead to stereotypes and explicit biases that then convert into oppressive behavior. So where are we at in the United States today related to that? So where we're at, overt expression of biases and oppression have broadly decreased in the United States. However, so what does that mean is hate crimes haven't decreased all that much. So taking that very end of the extreme of hate out, the overt expressions of racism and sexism and et cetera, those have generally in research been reported as happening less and less over the years. What has been increasing is the report of covert expressions of bias and oppression that continue to become more and more subtle, which led to the development of the concept of microaggressions. Okay, so has everybody heard the concept of microaggressions, at least in the media? Okay, what about in the classroom? Okay, some nods, yay. Okay, so just as a brief review, microaggressions then are brief, commonplace, daily verbal and behavioral and environmental indignities, whether intentional or unintentional, that communicate hostile, derogatory, or negative slights and insults to the person or group based on assigned group classification. Microaggressions often are invisible to the perpetrator. The person perpetrating microaggressions usually does not even recognize that they're doing it. Okay? And it also has the effect of blindsiding the recipient. The recipient doesn't see it coming, because very often it happens in very appropriate social positive interactions, or normative interactions at least. And then a microaggression will fall out into the interaction, and the person who was the target of the microaggression is left with wondering, what just happened there? How do I make sense of that? So to understand microaggressions, we're gonna talk about three different types of microaggressions. Micro assault, micro insult, and micro invalidation. Okay. A micro assault is more like explicit old school racism. So it is verbal or nonverbal attack with the intention of discriminatory actions or expression of biases. Typically, we don't do that all that often. The research shows that's decreasing. When we do express these kind of biases, it's very often done within the safety of one's intimate group, the privacy of one's intimate group. We don't walk around society much anymore just shooting off our mouth about all of our explicit biases. We kind of try to keep those private, unless it's an election year. Just kidding. Not really. The frequency is on, these incidences are on decline. And actually, when we look at research on with college students around microaggressions, the frequency of reported micro assaults on college campuses, is actually significantly lower than the other two types that we're going to talk about. So we tend to keep our overt explicit biases fairly quiet unless we're around family and friends that we feel comfortable sharing that with. The second type, which is much more common, is a micro insult. And these are environmental or interpersonal communications that communicate, they're received by the recipient as degrading or exclusionary messages. It can come across as rude or insensitive. It can come across in a way that demeans or puts down one's diverse identity or cultural heritage. And it can also be subtle snubs. So sometimes they can be nonverbal as well. So it's messages that convey that their contributions are not important and very often can be done in very either nonverbal or friendly ways. So let me give you a couple of examples of micro insults. My chemistry teacher was in shock when I got 103% on an exam. However, she wasn't shocked when two white kids did well. This was kind of hurtful, but after that, the teacher never doubted me. So this is a micro insult because it was received by the target as an assumption that because of her race, she was not smart enough to do well on the exam. Okay? But the teacher was probably like, oh, that's amazing. You know, you did great. Like, wow, where did that come from? And the teacher may have very much thought of it as a compliment, a positive reinforcement, a way to encourage the student, but it was received by the recipient as, you didn't expect me to do very well because of my race, and you just don't think I'm smart enough. Okay? Second one, you're so young and pretty, you don't need all these medications. My pharmacist says every time I pick up the prescription that keeps me out of the emergency room, I'm a young disabled woman. So, you know, that's a compliment. You're so pretty. What do you need all these medications for? Okay? It was received as an assumption that being disabled makes you inferior. Okay? You're not inferior, you're pretty. Another whole implicit bias, cultural value. So these two things don't match. Well, it says I'm less attractive, I'm less important, I'm less valuable because of my disability, even though it wasn't meant that way. Okay, micro-invalidations. So these are communications that exclude, negate, or nullify the thoughts or feelings or experiential reality of the minority or target recipient's experience. And so these are things that suppress awareness of difference in the perpetrator and maintains disparities in power and superiority dynamics. So basically, it's ways in which people maintain that cultural hierarchy of this group is better than that group and eliminates the potential influence of the target in the interaction. Okay, so the person who's being microaggressed against, their interaction is basically nullified, their contribution in the interaction. So here's an example. Yes, I understand you're Asian American, but where are you really from? Okay, so that can be received as an Asian American is not legitimately American as a Euro-American. Okay, and then you're not really black, you're more white on the inside. Okay, this can be received, and the people who say this, the first person probably actually wants to know what country of origin did your people come from, okay? But it's received as I'm not as legitimate as you are. Okay. And then the second one is I'm not legitimate because I don't conform to your stereotypes about my group. Okay. So it invalidates identity of the other person. Okay. And probably thought it was a compliment. Oh, you're not really black. You're white on the inside. Okay. Probably meant it as a compliment, but it invalidates their identity on the basis of not fulfilling a stereotype. Right? Okay. Understand how those work? All right, so I want to introduce you to the micro insults and micro invalidations are the majority of microaggressions that we see on campuses. And so what I want to do right now is I want to introduce you to the themes that we see. And actually, could you pass these around? Okay, thank you. And as I'm talking through these, you're going to get a handout. And in that handout is is a list, a table on this side, start on this side, that has the different themes. And as I talk through them, what I would like you to do is to identify in your own self what are ethnic groups where you have either yourself or either as a perpetrator or as a target or as an observer in any of those roles, you have observed microaggressions related to these. When you've been the recipient of these themes, put an asterisk next to it on the left. Okay, if you've been the recipient, an asterisk, and then what groups you've either been a perpetrator, a target, or a observer. Okay. So the first one, alien in one's own land. Okay, that's like that last example. Okay, I know you're Asian American, but where are you really from? Okay, Pasadena. You know, and now where are you really from? Alder Street in Pasadena? You know, I mean, you know, that sense of you're not actually American or whatever culture you come from. Ascription of intelligence. So in the research, this one tends to be perpetrated more often among Asian Americans than other ethnic groups. And that is, you know, you're Asian American, you must be smart. Okay, and it's an assumption that you're very smart based on your ethno-racial identity. The corollary of that is an assumption of inferiority. And in the research, we know that this happens more often to African Americans, and then after that to Hispanic Latinos. So, but it's this idea that you're not, in a college setting, it's the idea of you're not competent, you're not smart, you're not skilled, you're not legitimately present on campus. So that's that assumption of inferiority. Colorblindness. Colorblindness is the idea that I don't see color, I don't see race, I just see people, which is interesting because colorblindness, what that does is if I am a person of color and you refuse to see my identity as a person of color, who are you seeing when you look at me? What are you seeing when you look at me? Because I'm a person of color and that pervades every aspect of my identity. You know, so it nullifies, it invalidates, it's a micro-invalidation, it invalidates a chunk of a person's identity, often a substantial chunk. Criminality, assumption of criminal status, right? This one, sadly, research shows is more likely to happen to African-American males than any other group. I'm citing research from college campuses, not broadly, just the research from college. Assumptions that you know, I have to guard my stuff, I have to hold my purse tighter, you know, this person, if there's been a crime permitted, who do we look to first? Those would be acts of microaggressions. Denial of individual racism. So this often comes up when people are confronted with their microaggressions and it turns into another microaggression. And that is, oh no, I'm not racist, I didn't mean that at all. Okay, so denial of individual racism. We're going to talk in a little bit about what do we do when microaggressions are talked about, and we'll come back to that. Myth of meritocracy. You know, if you're having a hard time, you just need to try harder. You know, everybody gets the equal opportunities. Everybody gets the equal access. There's no reason that you shouldn't be successful because anybody can be successful if they just try hard enough. Okay, and what that does is that invalidates any of the systemic, any of the institutional, any of the societal systems that create barriers that make things more difficult for some groups more so than others. Okay. Pathologizing cultural values and communication styles. Okay. That's so ghetto is a good example of that. Okay. That is whether you think of that as a good thing or not. It's communicated in our society as a derogatory statement. Okay, so pathologizing cultural values, communication styles as well. This comes up with linguistic biases. People who don't sound like English is their first language will often be perceived and interacted with in a more demeaning, more negativistic way because There's a pathologizing of the communication. Second class status, you know, this goes back to that cultural hierarchy. You know, if you're not on, if in the hierarchy your group is below my group, you're a second class status. So sometimes that's related on college campuses, sometimes that's related to being a first-gen college student, sometimes it's related to being a student of color, sometimes it's related to being a sexual or gender minority. So second class status can come up in microaggressions on campus. And then environmental invalidations. I'm gonna talk about that one on the next slide, so I'll come back to that. Exoticism, so this one tends to happen more to Asian Americans than other groups. And that is the tendency to see a person because of their ethno-racial identity as exotic, you know, interesting, you know, romanticizing it, basically. Romanticizing a person because of their identity. And we see that most with Asian Americans, but we see it with other groups as well. But that the largest group that that reports that is the Asian American community. And then assumption of similarity. So that's that denial of differences. We're just different on the outside. We're the same on the inside. In fact, Ben Carson, in his election cycle, actually talked about that as a neuroscientist. You know, okay, the brains are roughly the same on the inside. But in saying that publicly, he kind of invalidated the diversity of people's lived experiences, people's realities, people's differences. Okay, let's talk about environmental microaggressions. This came up at the last meeting I was at. environmental microaggressions are the lack of inclusion or representation in privileged settings. That you also see environmental microaggressions in colorist preferences in representation of diversity. That is where, when you go to any one of our college websites, you'll be hard-pressed to find a picture that doesn't have a student of color in it, or a faculty of color, or somebody of color in it. It's a colorist preference in presentation of diversity. It doesn't necessarily mean that that diversity actually exists on campus. It's just we have this preference to try to make it show up. So it's a microaggression because it's objectifying students of color or faculty of color to, in many ways, misrepresent their reality of their lived experience. Okay. Tokenism in the media is another environmental microaggression. It's gotten better, actually, in the last 5 years, it's gotten better, but it's still the case that in most TV shows, if there are two African-American males on the show, you know one of them's gonna die soon. It's just that you watch it. Start watching. There are a few shows, I think largely on like the CW, that don't do that, but many shows tend to do that. And that is the idea of tokenism in the media. We need to have visible representation, but only just this much. The media is still predominantly oriented around and written towards and presented towards the dominant culture, the dominant group, Euro-Americans, and then we tokenize in our media other people. Okay. And then spotlighting is the example of I hate to like call anybody out, but sometimes at some universities you'll see things like spotlight on this student or spotlight on that student or spotlight on this faculty, and it's drawing an unrepresentative amount of attention to a person of color when they're not that it's unequal representation. They're getting spotlighted rather than saying, hey, we have all this diversity. You know, here's our diverse person. Check this person out. Okay? That's a form of a microaggression because, again, it's utilizing that person's diversity for alternative purposes. Does that make sense? Okay. So, as you have your sheet in front of you, spend a few minutes reflecting on when you have perpetrated these themes. Identify the ethno-racial groups that you've perpetrated them with or against. And then reflect on when you've been a target or a recipient and what themes were used. So spend a few minutes trying to identify the themes that you've perpetrated, the themes you've been a recipient of. Are you able to kind of see those themes as in your life, whether it's as a perpetrator or a target or an observer? Yeah. The last time I walked people through this, I had a live voting polling going on, and I didn't do it in here today because of time issues, but but most people reported seeing each one of those themes. It was a very high response rate of seeing these themes on college campuses, and so being perpetrated or received on college campuses. So last fall, meaning last semester, there was an article that was put out called The Coddling of the American Mind. Did anybody read it? Okay. So very interesting article, highly recommend reading it. I actually start my semester having my students read it because it was an article written by, I assume, some journalists that basically said that the focus on microaggressions and microaggression reduction on college campuses is turning your generation into a bunch of coddled, hypersensitive snowflakes who can't survive in the real world. And that we need to stop trying to reduce microaggressions and tell you guys to deal. Okay? To engage critically and have conversations. And it's a really interesting article. There's things about it that I think are really strong and things about it that I think are somewhat weak. But my take on it is we can reduce microaggressions and we can still resiliently engage in dialogue. And that's the point. That's the reason I developed this talk, was because it's like we can do something about it. Microaggressions will never completely go away. We want to raise awareness. We want to reduce their experience. But we want to be more productive, more effective in handling them when they do occur. Because right now, we're not using really good strategies in how to do that. But in defense of the authors of that article, one of the questions that they ask is, realistically, what is the impact of microaggressions? They're micro. They're not intended to be harm. Nobody's being beat down. No one's having experiences with a lot of overt racism. Why are we concerned about it? So real quickly, I'll just tell you why I think it's important. And one is that there's an extensive body of literature that has looked at the impact of microaggressions and racism-related stress on both the physical and psychological well-being of people who are recipients or targets of biases. And general well-being, health behaviors, psychological well-being, they're all impacted by the experience of being the recipient or target of microaggressions. And there's lots of research that backs that up, that this is something that really does have a psychobiological, physical response to microaggressions. And it decreases quality of life, it decreases well-being. In addition, unlike overt racism, microaggressions have an added effect or impact in terms of the attributional ambiguity that goes on. And so what happens is with overt racism, you know what's happening, right? With microaggressions, the recipient of the microaggression is left to think, okay, that hurt. I think that person just said this about me or my group. But they said it in such a way that I'm not sure if that's what I actually heard. Did I actually hear that? If I did hear that, am I being too sensitive? Am I taking it the wrong way? So that attributional ambiguity has been shown to have negative impacts on general well-being, psychological stress, and other health well-being measures. Not knowing, the thinking it through part, the having to spend time and energy going, what just happened there? Is that me? Is that them? What? I'm not sure what to do with this. Has its own health impacts. Okay. Impacts on college students in particular. So that was all the research generally. And research on the impact of microaggressions among college students has found that student learning is diminished, academic performance is diminished. Students who are more likely to be recipients of microaggressions report higher levels of distress, higher levels of anxiety, higher levels of feeling unsafe, of feeling like they're not in an environment that they can trust. They have distrust or they feel unsafe. Higher reporting of feeling invisible, feeling unvalued, okay, and lower self-esteem. Okay. Let me jump to this one. Some of the, because I already talked about the other one. some of the cognitive impacts. So when a microaggression occurs and the recipient is having to internally make sense of what just happened, what do I do with it? There are strategies that very often get used. One is denial minimalization. That didn't mean anything. That person didn't mean anything. It's no big deal. Or, you know, well, that person meant that about my group, but not me. I had to self-exceptionalize. Sometimes, and I think in Christian college, we're especially vulnerable to this one, and that is suppression of marginalized identity. Okay, my identity as a woman of color is not being really valued right now, so I'm going to focus more on being a Christian and leave my identity as a person of color out, because I don't have the time or the energy to deal with that. But we're all Christians, so I'll connect with people as Christians and deal with it that way. Okay. The challenge of that, and that happens not just in peer-on-peer, but that also happens in faculty and mentor relationships, where persons of color feel like they have to suppress their marginalized identity in order to have the same, not the same, but have a accessible, inviting environment. They have to leave their diversity at the door. Okay. And what that does is it makes it very difficult for marginalized students to bring their vocational identity that they're developing into their real world, into their real self, into their real community. Because when I'm at school, I'm a student. And then I go home and I'm a person of color. Okay? And how do I bring those two together? I don't, because I have to suppress that identity in my academic institution because nobody wants to hear about it, nobody values it. So that's a negative impact that I think we are particularly vulnerable to, because we have that shared identity as a Christian, that it's an easy default. Let's just connect as Christians. Self-blame, self-questioning, self-blame happen a lot. And then internalized oppression can come out of that, where people start to believe the negative attributes that are thrown at them. Okay? There's some great research that was done by Kenneth Clark like 50, 60 years ago on children's internalized oppression. And then a few years back, a high school student, I think, tried to replicate that study and found the exact same findings, where children of color, African American kids, would prefer white dolls over black dolls. Okay? African American kids, when asked which doll is good, selects the white doll. Which doll is bad, selects the black doll. Okay? That's internalized oppression. And unfortunately, when you are dealing with microaggressions, that happens here as well. Okay. All right. So can we all say microaggressions are something we want to decrease? Okay. We all engage in them, and we want to develop the ability to decrease how much we do them. Okay. So the question is, what do we do when microaggressions occur? Because microaggressions are linked to our implicit biases, they're going to happen. Failure is a reliable reality. Okay? We're gonna perpetrate microaggressions against each other. It happens. Hopefully we can decrease their frequency and continually decrease their frequency, but they're not gonna go away. So we're gonna need work on unlearning and recovering from microaggressions in here. But before we start talking about how do we do that, let's talk about what the goals are. Where are we working towards? So the goals of being able to unlearn and recover from microaggressions is to first develop and express cultural humility, which we'll talk about in a minute. Second, to engage in multicultural dialogue, which we'll talk about also in a minute. And then third, to move beyond conflict and engage in reconciliation and restoration. Okay. So the first goal, cultural humility. Okay? And that is a lifelong process of self-reflection, self-critique, and continual assessment of power imbalances, the development of mutual respectful relationships and partnerships. So this is the definition that came out of the area of psychology. However, cultural humility is also a construct that's come out of theology as well. And so it integrates very nicely. It is an idea that we have to work to build and commit to diverse relationships. We need to have a genuine effort to connect without that hierarchy and the demand to collude with that hierarchy being in place. We have to relinquish our dominance and power dynamics, and we have to be open to acknowledging our deficiencies, our failures, and being willing to engage with our failures and not resist doing so. Okay, so to go back to your self-assessment, from all the ones that you marked, think about one where you were the perpetrator. Okay, and on the back side of your paper, if you turn it over, there's a perpetrator incident. Okay, and what I'd like you to do is to write down what happened. Okay, no one's going to see these, so write down what happened when you were the perpetrator, how you responded when it happened. Did you not even know it happened? No one said anything. You moved on your merry way, or did something happen? And how did you respond when you were the perpetrator? Right. And then what I'd like you to do is to write in the alternate response what you think you could have done differently. After you've done that with being a perpetrator, do that also with being a target. When you remember one of the times when you were a target, write what happened, how you responded, how you might respond differently using cultural humility. Okay. If you're still working on it, keep working on it, because we're going to come back to this again in a few minutes. I see some people still working, those who aren't. Breathe. Okay, so the second goal is to engage in multicultural dialogue. A multicultural dialogue is discourse that embraces honest and critical feedback from diverse others, challenges our internalized assumptions about ourselves and about others, and works towards mutual understanding rather than relying on collusion or conformity demands to build trust and produce movement towards shared diversity journey. Okay? So it's dialogue that is based, this morning I'm going to talk about how to get to these things. We don't have time to go over that right now, but it's dialogue that comes from a genuine, open, learning recipient stance on both people in the dialogue, or all people in the dialogue, because you can do this in a group as well. Okay, so what I'd like you to do is to go back to your two incidents that you've written out, and think about how you could have, in your alternate response, responded in a way that would engage multicultural dialogue in that situation, with both as perpetrator and target. One thing I didn't mention as you guys are finishing up, one thing I didn't mention when we were talking about microaggressions and the types of microaggressions, microaggressions aren't always between group memberships. Microaggressions also occur within group membership. And so people microaggress against other members of their same in-group. So just, we all do it. Okay, so have you had a chance to write down some thoughts about how you could engage multicultural dialogue in those two situations? Okay, what I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna walk you through some tips. Some tips of before we go to the third goal, we're gonna walk through some tips of how can we engage around microaggressions. So I'm going to start by talking about if we can all put our perpetrator hats on. When we're a perpetrator, what can we do when we enact a microaggression, when we microaggress? Well, first we have to do, the first thing we have to do before we can do this is we have to work on that self-awareness we talked about earlier. So we have to become aware of our implicit biases so that we can become aware of our microaggressive behaviors that flow out of that. Once we notice we've engaged a microaggression, we've targeted somebody with a microaggression, we need to do a few things. One, don't ignore it. Okay? Start from a place of, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do it badly. I'm going to engage in microaggressions, and when I do, ignoring it doesn't erase it. Okay? Ignoring it definitely does not erase it. It usually punctuates it, accentuates it. Don't deny it. When they say, ouch, that hurt, in whatever way they say that, don't deny that you did it. Don't deny intent. Don't clarify intent. That's not what I meant. What I meant was, don't do that. Okay? Don't minimize it. I was just joking. No big deal. Don't minimize what has happened. Don't shift the attention to yourself. Okay? Don't And this is really hard, especially as Christians, because we are so motivated by guilt. So when somebody says, ouch, you really just offended me when you said that, our natural inclination is to be like, oh my gosh, I am so sorry. I did not mean to offend you. I did not mean to hurt you. That's our natural inclinations as Christians. We were socialized to that from the time we were verbal, 18 months. I'm sorry. But what that does is it shifts attention immediately from the target, the recipient of the microaggression, back onto yourself. Okay? So don't jump into apologizing too quick. And you have to resist that, especially as Christians. You got to resist that because it doesn't work yet in terms of it does not acknowledge the microaggression when you jump right into shifting the attention onto you and your state of guilt. Instead, what you want to do is listen. Listen to the concern. Listen to the person's experience. Listen to their feelings before you do anything else. Is hear them. Hear what happened. You were there. You did it. But hear their experience of what just happened. Listen to their story. Ask any questions that you need to understand better. Okay? Because part of what we're trying to do is reduce how often we do microaggressions, right? So you've got somebody who said, ouch, that really offended me. That really hurt. Listen, and if you don't fully understand, ask questions before you move to apologizing. That's going to mean more in terms of re-engaging. We're going to talk about reconciliation in a few minutes. That's going to mean more if you do this first, if you listen and you understand and you hear the person's part of their understanding of what just happened between you. When you do respond, before you do respond, you want to be aware that we have a couple of vulnerabilities that we tend towards. Be aware that we, as a society, generally do not like social discomfort. Okay, and so very often, levels of intimacy influence how comfortable we are. Okay, so if somebody is a very close friend or family, and they confront you with something, it may be easier to take than if somebody is more of just a friend or an acquaintance and they confront you with that. And so that social discomfort can make it very easy for us to try to avoid having that conversation. So recognize that you know, as a perpetrator, when you start having a dialogue about the microaggression, it's gonna have some level of discomfort. And our natural tendency is to try to get out of that. Get away from discomfort, move into comfort. And we have to resist that because we need to work through the microaggression interaction. One of the things we're also really good at is using our power and dominance to mitigate these kinds of conversations by demanding collusion. And so when you think about power and dominance, power positions, power dynamics. Oh, I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Okay, let's go to that slide. we'll come back to that in just a second. The other thing you want to be aware of is cultural collusion. And cultural collusion is the tendency to connect with each other around non-threatening shared identities. So if a microaggression occurs, let's say it's a racial microaggression, there may be an instinct to, you know, connect as guys or connect as ladies or to connect as Christians and kind of avoid that conversation because it's easier to collude around that. Okay? I think a good example that I see happen a lot is sports. Mostly with guys. When this cultural collusion occurs, when something is not super comfortable, they start talking about sports. And it makes it all better. Except that it doesn't get talked about. What made everybody uncomfortable in the first place doesn't get talked about. So it doesn't actually make it all better. Okay, so we want to be attentive to the issue of power dynamics. And power dynamics flow out of our implicit attitudes and behaviors. So we express our power dynamics in our verbal and our nonverbal behavior, and very often we're not aware of them. It's part of the output of implicit biases, is how we situate ourselves in power relationships. Okay, how we situate ourselves. And so one of the things you need to recognize is we have a tendency to utilize our power to get out of uncomfortable situations. Okay? And so when you're trying to engage in a dialogue about microaggressions, You got to be careful to pull back on that. That our tendency is to, if we can get out of it through collusion or avoidance, we'll do that. If we can get out of it through exerting our power, we will do that as well. So we need to try to really work towards power balancing and having conversations. And I think a good way of measuring power balance is everybody involved in this conversation equally uncomfortable? Okay. We focus a lot on being comfortable. We're going to focus on here is everybody equally uncomfortable in this conversation? Because if everybody's equally uncomfortable in the conversation, then we're working towards power balancing. Okay. So you want to make sure that, especially if you're coming from a position of greater power, that you're attuned to that and you relinquish that power to have this conversation. Okay. So these are, and I'm not talking just peer-on-peer here, I'm talking faculty and student and staff and student relationships, that there has to be this desire to, I got a power balance because I've microaggressed and I need to engage in a conversation about it. And so for that period of time, we have to power balance to have this conversation. Okay, so go back to your alternate response. And think through these things that we just talked about in terms of what not to do, what to be aware of, and write a little bit about what else you could add to your alternate response based on the last 5 minutes. Is there other things you can add to your alternate response? So, now there's probably more, but I've just realized I'm running behind, so I'm going to keep going. What I want to talk about now is when we're going to take off our perpetrator hat and put on our target hat. When we have been the recipient of a microaggression, what are some things that we need to know to engage around microaggressions and cope effectively? First thing to know is research really does show that a strong, secure ethnic identity or religious identity or whatever identity is that you're in a marginalized or non-dominant group in, a strong identity is a great mediator of well-being in multicultural contexts where oppressive behavior is going on. Okay? So having a good sense of one's own self, having that strong connection. Another important piece is to recognize that tokenism, silencing or singling out can occur and address it when it's beneficial. Okay, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. When is it beneficial? But, well, I guess we can talk about it right now. But recognize when those things are happening. Those are types of microaggressions. Tokenism, singling out, silencing. Those are the micro-invalidations and micro-insults. And when they happen, recognize them as such. And then decide whether or not you should talk about it, should call it out. And one of the ways you can do that is to have a sense for what is the other person's stance. Are they willing and able to have a conversation? Because if they're at a place where they're not willing and able, you'll run into your own frustration with, I'm trying to be involved in having a resolution here, and I'm just getting more aggressions thrown at me. Microaggressions thrown at me. And so part of what can be helpful is one, building diverse relationships. Secondly, getting to know identity development models and know when somebody is more open based on where they're at and how they're behaving and when somebody is more closed. Because one of the things is as a target, if you are in a visible minority marginalized group, you tend to get targeted a lot. Okay? And if you try to have this conversation with every microaggression you experience, you're going to burn out. You're going to get very tired. And so you have to begin to assess, when is it a good use of my resources to have this conversation and when is it not? Okay, so you want to try to engage in that kind of a conversation with yourself in terms of looking at that person that's involved. Is this a relationship that can become a multicultural dialogue, that cultural humility can be developed in our interaction with each other? All right, in addition for targets, it's really important that you connect meaningfully with culturally relevant peers. One of the things that research has shown us about college students on predominantly white campuses is that ethnic social connections are extremely important. They help keep you connected. They help keep you feeling sane. They help keep you working through college. When people in marginalized groups on college campuses don't have a solid support network, they're more at risk for not making it to graduation, of dropping out of school or changing schools, which anytime you change schools, it lengthens time to graduation, and risk of graduating risk of not graduating goes up. Okay, so that's really important. But in addition to ethnically similar connections, it is important for you to develop peers that are diverse, because most of us are on college campuses where the number of people of color is substantially fewer than the number of Euro-Americans. And so you want to develop a broad social network. A good, solid social support system is important. And so what you want to do is look for meaningful relationships with culturally relevant peers. And what that can be is people who have a multicultural mind. They're oriented towards that. They value multiculturalism. Here at this conference, you have both dominant and minority students who are culturally minded. They want to promote diversity, unity on your campuses. And so find those people and build supportive networks of support. That can be done by looking at behavior, cultural competence behavior, and also looking at identity, getting to know people and seeing where they're at in their own multicultural journey. Okay. When you are a target, some research, there needs to be a lot of the stuff that I'm reporting on, there's a need for more research on, and one of the areas that we do need more research on is spiritual coping strategies. There's been some research that has shown that spiritual coping strategies can be effective in mitigating the effects of microaggressions. That's things like prayer, meditation, connecting with your spiritual support community, and so utilize that. We need more research. I'm pretty sure the research will bear it out as we get more research on it, but because it bears it out on other health-related conditions. But utilize those resources to help with coping as well. Okay. So I kind of already talked about this, but let me just point out a couple more things. How do you know if somebody is a good relationship to invest in responding to microaggressions? In addition to the learning stance, are they willing to talk about hard topics? Hard topics, being able to talk about things that are hard to talk about without getting defensive, without insisting that they're right or you need to see things their way. Are they able to socially situate themselves? And what that means is, are they able to see themselves as a cultural person with a cultural perspective? Because if they can see themselves as a cultural person with a cultural perspective, they're probably going to be better able to see you as a cultural person with a cultural perspective. All right, so that is some coping tips for both when we have our perpetrator hats on, when we have our target hats on. The third goal that we're working towards is reconciliation and restoration. We want relationships. The whole point of engaging around the microaggressions is to restore a relationship, right? And so in the diversity movement, reconciliation does include restoration, realigning of a relationship. An alliance is formed or restored. In the Christian diversity movement, reconciliation is considered the message of Christianity. The gospel is about reconciling people to God and to each other. You'll find a repetitive theme in the New Testament where it's love the Lord your God and, you know, your neighbor, your brother, as yourself. So very often loving God and loving each other goes hand in hand. And so reconciliation is considered an imperative of the Christian faith, and it requires us to have an interpersonal orientation towards reconciliation and a commitment to doing so throughout our lives. Okay. Reconciliation is not just about getting along or being at peace with God. Okay. It's not merely a political end to conflict or mediation without healing. Reconciliation is always a journey of transformation and healing. Okay, so it's restoration is a form of healing. Ideally, as we're going through the process of active reconciliation across our lifetime, we are also beginning to have a transformative worldview. That the way that we understand ourselves, the way that we understand our context, the way we understand our community is transformed. And one of the transformations that needs to be part of the process of reconciliation is learning to live in tension. We, at least in the American culture, we don't like tension. Like, we're all about comfort, we're all about relaxation, we're all about entertainment. It's where our economy is essentially based. All our smart devices are all about that, right? So we're very much oriented in our society towards non-tension, okay? But part of this process is gonna be learning to live in tension, to recognize that we are broken and that we have to constantly be in the process of healing. That we have to have these conversations ongoing. They're not a one-off conversation. It's a lifelong conversation of reconciliation and restoration. Reconciliation also transforms your alliances. Who is in your in-group and who is in your out-group will begin to shift when you engage in the practice of reconciliation. Okay. So right now in America, we very much orient ourselves by in-group, out-group, by race, by social class, by our closest communities, okay? When we engage in reconciliation, those borders between my in-group and my out-group begin to shift, okay? And people that I've reconciled with will become part of my in-group. And my in-group begins to grow and become more diverse because I'm practicing reconciliation and I'm transforming who is my peeps, right? Transformation of interpersonal orientation occurs. Superiority dynamics, power dynamics begin to diminish. Cultural humility begins to really become a primary expression. And we will begin to see all those fruits of the Spirit that we learn in Scripture that we look for in relationships with each other. Those will begin to emerge. Right. I already mentioned this. Reconciliation is healing. You have to deal with those pains and injuries and misunderstandings. So you have to be able to hear each other's experiences. Okay. All right. So how far am I doing? I'm not doing good. conflict in relationships is that reliable reality. We're gonna have problems with each other, and so. Persons in successful relationships, what does it take to successfully get through to restoration and reconciliation? People who can restore the relationships, they do these things. One, they avoid becoming exclusively self-focused. Okay? When there's a relationship problem, there's actually at least two people involved in that relationship problem. And if we can keep that in mind and focus on the relationship, focus on the other, then we can begin to not make it all about ourselves and making ourselves comfortable and feel good and reinforce those beliefs about ourselves that we prefer to reinforce. We need to remain mindful and attentive to the other person and their experience in the conflict. When there's an argument, it's the first thing we do is kind of pull into our own corner, right? We make sure we got all of our weapons ready to go before we start fighting, right? And that is very much a self-focused engagement around conflict. What you want to try to work to is recognize that this is a conflict between the two of us, which means I'm experiencing what I'm experiencing as we have a disagreement, but you're experiencing something as well. And I'm not sure what that is. Maybe I can find out what that is. Okay. Another thing you need to do if you're going to pursue reconciliation and restoration is you have to trust in the positive desires of both persons. Don't forget that each person is really trying to be successful in building a relationship. Okay? The way in which the other may go about it may not be the way you would like them to go about it, but you can trust that the intent is to build that relationship. You have to be able to see the best intent in the other. Okay, because if you can't trust that the other person actually has a desire to restore relationship and to reconcile, then you're not gonna have a successful outcome of your conversation. Okay, and then initiate conversations with a soft startup. Okay, and a soft startup involves acknowledging positive things first before you jump into attacking. okay? And not because you're going to jump into attacking. You're actually not going to jump into attacking. you're going to acknowledge positive things about the relationship, positive things about what you appreciate about the other, okay? And then you're going to share your experience, okay? Sharing your experience without saying you is really hard, okay? I have couples who spend a lot of time in therapy working on just that one skill. Could you re-say that without saying you? Because when we are upset with each other, we tend to say, well, you did this or you said that. And a soft startup involves saying, here's what I experienced. Here's what I felt. Here's what I am thinking is going on. Okay? So it's sharing your experience, sharing your story without hurling accusations. Okay. And then it also involves staying focused on the one problem at hand. We tend to, in general, I think we all tend to do this, we tend to fight by bringing in every little thing that we can use as a weapon, right? And so if we're having a conflict about this particular interaction that just happened, we'll use evidence from previous interactions that we didn't talk about and bring those in. Right? I know this is it because you did this a month ago. You did this a week ago. That is not helpful. That won't get to success. Okay? Staying focused on one problem at a time is the best way to get to a successful restoration. Okay. Also, avoid personal criticism. Okay. Again, assume the best about the other person and hope for solutions. Hope for that you're going to work it out. You guys are going to restore your relationship. Okay? If you introduce personal criticisms, I can almost guarantee that you won't restore the relationship in that conversation. Okay? The minute that you start saying negative things about each other, you're not going to reconcile. You might reconcile next week. You might reconcile tomorrow. But right now, you're not going to reconcile because you've just said something insulting or mean or demeaning to each other. Okay? So personal criticisms, big taboo. Okay. And then demonstrate cultural humility by making space for people, being willing to give people space to resolve any emotional flooding that comes up. So emotional flooding is when you get emotionally upset to the point that you're physiologically responding to your upset emotions. Okay? And when that happens, there's tons of research that shows that when that happens, productive resolution of problems will not occur. When you are both physically activated and emotionally upset, our brains do not work in problem-solving mode. Our brains actually go into survival mode. And so then we run back to fight or flight. Okay? Very often fight. and so cultural humility would ask us that when we recognize that this is a conversation that has led to flooding, that we take a step back and we give each other space, reschedule the conversation for another time. Okay. Why don't we take a break? You know, can we meet for coffee tomorrow? Can we have breakfast tomorrow? You know, and set up a time to try it again where flooding isn't present. Okay. Another important thing to recognize about restorative conversations is that some problems are difficult to solve. Now, I know this will come as a shock to you, especially if you've ever had to have conversations about diversity with anybody other than yourself. That differences in perspectives, differences in beliefs, those are pretty foundational things about us. And changing them, solving differences in beliefs, differences in perspectives, may not happen the first time you have that conversation. Okay? The transformation of worldview that occurs with reconciliation is a process. It's not a conversation. It's a process of multiple conversations. And so you have to recognize that some conversations that you're going to have where you're trying to restore and reconcile aren't going to end with the happy ending of now they see it my way that you're hoping for. Okay? That reconciliation and restoration sometimes has to involve saying, okay, we see things differently in terms of the background stuff, you know, and we understand each other and we care for each other and we're going to continue to move on in our relationship. Okay, so that's where acts of forgiveness come in, and trust restoration. Don't give up on each other just because you can't solve that problem yet. Okay, you got to keep that relationship intact. All right. Additionally, for reconciliation, there is this issue of becoming allies. Okay, we need to become allies, which means that we need to develop the theology of living in shalom. And shalom means that we are exhibiting love in action. Okay, and what that sometimes means is that we have to be able to bear each other's burdens, become allies in each other's concerns, and sometimes that may mean that we need to fulfill the demands. I saw you guys have like Micah 6:8 on your t-shirts today. the demands of Micah 6:8, which is to love, mercy, justice, and faith. And the idea is that sometimes there's cultural differences around justice in terms of what one person thinks is necessary for justice versus what another person might think is necessary for justice. And so Christian allies, as Christians, even if it's not my burden that I'm sharing, I'm sharing your burden. As an ally, we need to work for social structures. We need to work for change. We need to be active, behavioral, in upholding the dignity and worth of all individuals, empowering the poor and marginalized, and resisting the abuse of wealth and power, and work towards providing equitable, non-discriminatory access to resources and opportunities. So these are some of the burdens that brothers and sisters are carrying. And as Christians, living in shalom means that we have to carry those burdens too. And we need to be willing to engage in social action in order to work towards the social systems that won't do these things, or will do these things, will uphold and empower and won't abuse wealth and power and won't provide inequitable experiences. All right, last one I'm going to mention is part of reconciliation and restoration is sharing joys and sorrows. Authentic and mutual celebration of joy and authentic grieving of sorrows is an important piece of reconciliatory living. Okay, what that means is we have to know each other. We have to spend time with each other. We have to build relationships and communities that genuinely actually care about each other. Okay, it's not a platitude, it's a reality. A care that is a reality. Okay, you know what I'm talking about, platitudes? Yeah, we do a lot of platitudes. But the idea being that we care about each other enough that when we're reconciled, we actually know each other. We actually care about what's going on in that person's life, in that community's lives, and we step into their world with each other, genuinely present, actually present. Not just wishing them best of luck and sorry about your loss and congratulations on that. Celebrate and grieve.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically centered degree programs ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.